Good evening, Yuvraj. Yuvraj will start in another 5 minutes. दीपाली माझा आवाज येतोय ना?
हो मॅम, येतोय.
Madam, am I audible?
Yes, now you are. Good evening, Yuvraj. We'll join in another 5 minutes. We'll start in another 5 minutes.
I'm not able to hear you, ma'am. Am I audible?
You are audible. Yeah. Hello.
मॅम त्यांना विचाराय, त्यांच्याकडनं अजून कोणीतरी जॉईन करणार आहे का? NLC असं म्हणून येतंय मला.
Is someone else joining from your side?
Exit and rejoin. I would that solve the problem? I'll try because I am not just able to hear you.
Okay.
Hello.
Hello, am I audible now?
Yes, you are audible, ma'am. Yeah.
Good evening, Yuvraj.
Good evening, ma'am.
We'll start in another 5 minutes.
Sure, no problem. I'll just mute my mic.
Yeah. Yuvraj?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, you can hear me, right?
Yes, I can.
Okay, so we'll begin?
Yeah, sure.
I'll introduce. Good evening, the participants. Today we have with us Mr. Yuvraj Narvankar, who has graduated from ILS with a gold medal. And he is LLM from the Bombay University. He has been conferred honorary fellowship by the prestigious Chartered Institute of Arbitrators, London. And he has he is a ranker so far as his LLM is concerned. He's done his course in cyber laws from the Asian School of Cyber Laws. Again, there he is ranked first. He has completed his advanced diploma course in entrepreneurship administration and business laws from NUJS Calcutta and housing laws with first rank. He has worked with Mr. Rafiq Dada, who was an additional Solicitor General of India. And he was working in his chamber up to the time he set up his independent practice. Mr. Narvankar is currently practicing in the High Court of Mumbai and also extensively appearing in the Supreme Court and the NCLT Mumbai branch. He has been an advisor to Navi Mumbai cyber cell. He has been empaneled and he appears for India Government Mumbai. He is empaneled for India Security Press Nashik. He has more than 65 reported judgments in constitution, education, and civil laws. He regularly writes in the reputed journals like Legal Era, Chamber of Tax Consultants, Maharashtra Law Journal, SCC, and reputed newspapers like Lok Satta, Maharashtra Times, and Sakar. He is a guest faculty for LLM in ILS Law College, as well as Symbiosis and Shaji Law College. He has conducted more than 160 lectures, seminars on diverse topics like cyber law, arbitration, property issues, and to name a few. He has many awards to his name. He was awarded the Raghavendra Fadnis Legal Aid Award for extensive legal aid work. He has also won the Shivarashtra Bhushan in the year 2017, and Lok Satta, he has also won the Lok Satta Tarun Tejankit Award in 2019 by the Indian Express Group. Yuvraj, it's a pleasure to have you for this session, and he will be speaking today on the substantive reliefs. The past 2 days, we've done multi-party disputes and rules of pleading. Now we will be looking into the substantive reliefs. Yuvraj, I leave the class to you.
Thanks a lot, madam, for firstly inviting me and for having me here. Am I audible, ma'am, properly? Is there any disturbance?
Yes. No,
it's
no.
Fine, right?
Yeah.
It's a great pleasure to be here, of course, because it's an ILS, my alma mater, and looking at the course, the way it has been designed, the only thing that I felt bad about was we didn't have it immediately after we passed out, because looking at the topics that the course seeks to cover, I think this is something, a fantastic opportunity for the lawyers, young, mid-level, and of course for all the lawyers from all walks of life. To get a refresher course, I would say, or to refresh certain concepts. Without wasting much time, let me start with, friends, the topic today. And let me just tell you that I'd wish to again take you back to the college days, and we again mug up the same thing, the CPC and the orders and all that. I wish to have it little different this time, because I wish to share what I where I have gone wrong, where I have committed mistakes, and where are the pitfalls, because I look at it as a journey of any young lawyer where he commits too many mistakes, and of course we look at those mistakes as the learning stones, but I just wish to share with you what are the pitfalls in these kind of pleadings, particularly plaint. And I will try my best not to transgress, because looking at the way the whole thing has been structured, most of the topics are being covered by absolutely learned advocates with great experience, to whom we look up to. So I would not at all digress from my topic, but certain digressions will be inevitable looking at the pleadings. The subject of pleadings is such a diverse pleading, such a diverse topic. I'll begin. If there are any issues, you can ask me maybe when I'm speaking, or you can reserve your queries, I think, the way moderator wants and the way you want. But let it be a dialogue. If I ask you a question, just to make it more participative, please feel free to switch on your mic and say something. That will give me a little classroom feel, you know. We are missing the warmth, and we are missing that classroom setup. Let's try to minimize that difference. Okay, let's begin. Friends, there is a big difference between the trial court advocacy and appellate court advocacy. Let me start with that note. I had my share of trial court advocacy when I started in a law firm, And when I was with Mr. Rafiq Dada, who was a, he is a living legend on the original side of the Bombay High Court. And there we learned a lot of things. And I mean by that, there are a lot of things which are different from the appellate lawyers to the trial court lawyers. The first most important distinction is this, that the appellate court lawyers get the instructions in a very formulated manner. You know, you have a lawyer who has already prepared the pleadings. You have the lawyer who has already taken the evidence. You have the judgment of the court, and then you prepare your appeal. It's like, you know, making a critical comment on a sculpture which is already prepared by some artist, just to make a critical comment, you know. But the trial court advocacy is to make the sculpture, you know, from that stone, from you have to literally start from the scratch and you have to give it a shape. And that's something very critical. So I would say the task of the appellate court lawyer begins when he receives the papers. He receives it with the instructions that please file appeal, please file petition. We need to challenge this. We need to file a petition to challenge the virus of this act or whatever. But the task of the trial court lawyer, and that's what we are going to today talk about, is much difficult because he does not have a set road. It's all wide ground open out there, and he has to decide his own course of journey. If he commits a mistake of 2 inches, you know, at the beginning, the difference in the destination would be 2 kilometers. You know, if you are mistaken by 2 inches at the beginning of your journey, the destination would be far away from where you wish to reach. So I think that's very important that the pleadings, the plaint really begins in all kinds of suit, specific performance, partition, and we are going to deal with all of it in the time that today we have. But the journey is same. And of course, we will be going to each specific suit and how it really looks like and how it should look like. But I think the basics of it remain more or less the same. And that's the reason I want to first major portion of my talk will be what are the common factors that you wish to really address. I'm completely conscious of the fact that the plaint has been spoken about by my previous speaker. Of course, order 6 and 7 might have been taken care of. I presume that. If I'm wrong in that presumption, please feel free to stop me and ask me to address something they wish me to address. But I'm presuming certain things for the sake of expeditious address. Friends, when the client comes to you, your task begins. Now, I would say that for drafting of a plaint, maybe of a specific performance, injunction, declaration, etc., recovery of money, summary suit, whatnot, you must first ensure that you have the all instructions, and I'll be brushing up these basics in 10 minutes. You must ensure that you have all, I underline all in all caps, instructions before you embark on your journey of plaint drafting. I myself have had my own share of problems because I was always, as a young lawyer, a little excited when I got a brief, and I immediately rushed. I sat down with the papers, I started the draft. I worked in a solicitor's firm, you know, and there the importance was given to the way you draft, the language that you use, the expressions that you use, all that your expression power really mattered a lot. So there was a temptation to ignore very essential part of the whole journey, and that was to take instructions. So please make sure you take a plain white paper whenever a client comes to you and start from the scratch. Sometimes the client get little irritated that please don't cross-examine me, this is my issue, that's completely irrelevant. Particularly in family matters, you would find that clients don't like little personal questions. Even in property matters, client feel, you know, little insecure if you try to probe them, if you try to rub them in the wrong way, if you try to cross-examine them. They feel that as if their own lawyer is cross-examining them, and precisely that's what they should feel. So always remember, when the client comes to you, please be the cross-examiner and most brutal person that they have seen in their legal journey. You would not lose a client because of that, believe me, because client at the back of their mind very well know that if this lawyer is probing me so much, there is something in him, there is a reason for this, and I must disclose everything to him. Initially, they will look little reluctant, little uneasy, but in the course of time, they will understand what exactly you want from them. and then they will start opening their cards. I'm deliberately using the word opening their cards because the tendency of the client, which is very dangerous, is to hide some facts and then come to you with some predetermined litigation in their head. Like in Maharashtra, we get a client which say, even in Mumbai on the original side, we get such a client who are so much seasoned litigants that they tell me, sir, apne ko declaratory suit file karna hai, you know, and sir, apne ko injunction dalna hai, sir, apne ko recovery karna hai, apne ko summary suit chalega kya? You know, these are the words that we day in day out hear from the clients. So basically, they come to us with a very predetermined litigation strategy, and which is most dangerous thing, my friends, because they are not supposed to decide the course of action. It's we who are going to decide the course of action. All they need to give to us is the bare facts, nothing more. They can't give us this advice. They can't give us the course of action. They can't tell us the law. So please collect those raw facts. And don't collect the facts only about the cause of action. Don't collect the facts as to what happened. Let me tell you, the story is going to be the same. If it's an injunction suit, they are going to tell you, sir, I was cultivating, these people came, I have the neighbor's testimony, we tried to stop them, they did not listen to us, then we went to police station, then they will take out some newspaper cutting to show you that, look, sir, this incident quoted in newspaper, we filed NC. Because FIR is not taken by police so casually, so they will show you some NC. The story is going to be the same. So please don't be satisfied with that story of the client. That version is absolutely same in all the cases. What you should be concerned with is what is the surrounding factual scenario, that who is, what's relation between the parties inter se. Was there ever a partition? No, I'm just taking the examples. Please don't go by the words that I'm using, partition and all. We will be dealing with those topics separately. I'm just giving you an example. That was there a partition? Are they cultivating as tenants in common? What relationship between them? Are there any family court proceedings pending between them? Was there any previous litigation between them? Was there a result of it? Was it challenged? If not, then why? If yes, then what was the outcome of the challenge? So think of as many questions as you can and ask them to the client. And please don't satisfied with his silence. If he says, sir, I need to come out with, let me recollect, I'll revert tomorrow. Then please, sir, come tomorrow, give me all the instructions. I'm telling you, the clients inevitably hide inconvenient facts. That's the natural tendency of the client, and that costs you the matter, not only matter, that costs you the face value. By face value, I don't mean the face value what's spoken about Mr. Dada or whoever the senior counsel, no. Friend, one, Council of 10 days standing has some face value. Face value, I don't mean the face value as we speak about the senior counsels, but face value means the credibility quotient. Your credibility quotient tremendously comes down if you are told some facts or you realize some fact in the course of the litigation and not beforehand. Okay? You look really, really lame and pathetic in front of the court, in front of the opposing counsel, and believe me, nothing is more embarrassing from the, more than that. So please never ever fall in that trap of lack of instructions. Let me tell you another problem with this. Generally what happens, we get the papers, we call the client, and then we sit over it sometimes, you know, because of work or because of little lethargy, we sit over the documents, and then the day comes, clients start calling us, you know, please, sir, apna kaam hua ki nahi, I need to file this. Please let me know what's the status, what is the progress. And then we rush into drafting the plaint. This inevitably happens. Then my advice to such lawyers and to myself in those time was, sorry, I could not do it in time. Please give me some more time. I'll be taking one more week. Please never ever, just to make a good initial impression, rush to start the plaint. I'll tell you what are the stages in a plaint. I would not, as I told you, would not be taking you to order 6, order 7, that has been covered one. And that's something that you can read even for yourself, what a plaint has to contain, what the pleadings have to contain, what WS has to contain under order 8. I'm not going to unnecessarily reteach you rediscuss those same things. I want to give you a little different outlook, and of course these things will follow. Most importantly, friends, there are certain aspects that you need to really take care of when the client comes to you. Before pleadings have started, before the pleadings begin, there is a temptation among certain lawyers to send notice. Let's see what they want to say. Let's see what's their defense looks like. Let's see what's their version. Friends, nothing is more riskier than unnecessarily sending the notice. Of course, notice to send the notice in certain cases is mandatory. But if you wish to send the notice, be sure that you are with the theory of your case beforehand. If you're not sure of theory of your case, never ever send the notice unnecessarily and premature. Because the theory that you set up in your notice is going to accompany the client and is going to be the fate of the client for years to come. Maybe till next 40 to 50 years, till the matter travels to Supreme Court. A document made in a rush on some evening while taking a sip of the tea is going to decide the fate of a family for next 40 years. That's how the important notice is. For example, if the client comes to me and if he tells me, sir, this is the property left behind by my father, sir, I know that there was a will kept under the table in the drawer, sir, I have the will. But no one knows about it, sir. My father was staying with me in his last days, so I know about it. A very simple factual situation. Friends, here you have a doctrine of election. Not in the sense that the law understands it. You need to really assess whether the will looks credible. You need to assess the person that has come to you is credible. You need to see whether the contents of the will are unconscionable or the conscionable. Is it coming from the proper custody? Of course, he claims to be a son, so it's a proper custody. Because here you need to make a choice before sending a notice. Suppose if you wish to send a notice because the son is complaining that, look, after death of my father, then they are trying to evict me. This is what he is going to tell you. So you need to really send them a notice. So are you going to send them the notice for injunction? Are you going to send them the notice for nuisance? I'm just wild thinking. Are you going to send them notice that, look, my client has inherited this property by will? Or forget about will, my client claims by in testamentary succession, non-testamentary succession, that whatever falls to him as per Hindu law, he is going to claim. So the choice that you are making at this juncture is going to stay with you or stay with your client for time to come. So please don't rush into sending the notice because the stance that you take is going to remain. So this is very important for the aspect of notice. These are the hazards basically associated with the notice. Same with the reply to the notice, because the what you say in reply to a notice, in fact, just a week before, I was advising a very high level official of a very reputed private corporation in her personal matter. And there she has received a notice about a transaction that has happened 12 years before. And a solicitor's firm has had advised her to send a reply, a very well elaborate, detailed reply. I personally felt that reply was not necessary because there was no cause of action for those guys to file anything. But her reply to the notice was such that was giving them enough ammunition to launch a litigation, maybe in the Gujarat court or wherever they wanted to file. So I deliberately avoided to give her a reply and I told her that this is my advice to you, that don't give a reply. There were two such instances. She and her brother had received the notice. The brother was based out of Surat. You won't believe, the brother had addressed a reply to the friend of theirs. He had sent a similar notice. I'm told last week that he has received a notice of a litigation. And they have referred to certain admissions that he made in the reply. Vis-a-vis, I just pray that my client doesn't receive it, but at least now it's 3 weeks, I think, have passed. She hasn't yet received the notice. 3 or 4 weeks have passed. I hope and pray that she doesn't receive it. But the point I'm telling you is that don't give the ammunition to the other side by way of your reply. Okay. Second, while drafting the plaint, most important concept is the burden of proof. Now, you might think that burden of proof is something that comes in when the litigation is going, when the litigation is at the stage of evidence. I would say burden of proof is the single most important thing when you start with the plaint. Because burden of proof is not really something that you discharge when it comes to evidence. Burden of proof is a concept that should be aware of the moment client steps into your office and the moment client starts giving you the instructions. I'll give you an example. Suppose a client comes to you and says that, sir, mere ghar ke saamne ye kooda kachra pada hai. There is this dustbin lying just in front of my home and I want to get rid of it. Is enough? This is causing me a real nuisance. and the entire locality is suffering. I have two options. I have so many options. One, I can file a suit against municipal corporation, right? I can file a police complaint of maybe some nuisance or causing danger to safety and all, health and all. I can file a public interest litigation in the High Court after sending municipal corporation notice and they're not replying to me, as is expected. I can file also Section 91 suit of Code of Civil Procedure. If you look at CPC, you have a public nuisance suit you can file. I can file a representative suit under Order 1, Rule 8. You know, all these options are open to me with the same cause of action. So how am I going to take that call? The call that I'm going to take entirely depends on what are the documents that I have. How much serious my client is about the litigation. Is he ready to discharge the burden of proof that PIL is going to put on him? If you know the PIL rules of the High Court, they are quite strict nowadays. You have to deposit the cost, you have to make certain declarations, you have to make certain, give some undertakings and all that. You have to have the RTI documents ready with you. Is he able to discharge that burden of proof of a PIL? He is not. So I'll come down to Section 91. Is it a fit case for Section 91? Because you need the prior leave of the court under Section 91. And you need to really show that there is a public nuisance and it's not a private cause. He doesn't seem to be, again, fit for that case. I come down to Order 1, Rule 8. The point that I'm trying to make, or let's take a recovery amount, recovery of money, a suit. I have a suit. I have the recovery of money ka case. I can simply go for recovery of money suit. I can go, if there is a check bouncing, I can simultaneously go for 138. I can go for insolvency petition. If the other side is a private limited company, I can go for insolvency petition. Why not? And this way, I have a multiple options when the client comes to me, and the burden of proof concept starts from that very beginning. You know, because please remember this golden rule that the burden of proof is not carried by the lawyer. The burden of proof is carried by the client. Please see if your client is capable of carrying that burden of proof. If the answer is an affirmative, then undertake your voyage, do the adventures that you wish to. But if your client's shoulders are not broad enough and strong enough to undertake that burden, please don't start on this is going to be the misadventure. Because it's like this, that if I aim for Everest, you know, it's not me who is going to climb. I'm just a Sherpa. It's my client. He's a climber. Can he undertake a voyage to Mount Everest summit? If not, then fine. Then decide the aim of some hill like Parvati. He can climb that easily. So why should I unnecessarily heighten the burden that I need to discharge? What happens is this, that in the jest and in the enthusiasm, I set such a high burden that then to my horror, I realize, oh, my client doesn't have absolutely anything with him. In terms of evidence, when it comes to evidence, then I realize that, oh, I should not have pleaded like this. I don't have anything to support my pleading. And this is the worst thing that can happen in a case. So, in fact, in one of my webinars, I had quoted a very senior learned counsel of the Bombay High Court in his lecture given at Bombay Bar, where he said that he always makes it a point to prepare the affidavit of evidence at the time when he drafts the plaint, you know. What we call puravacha shapat patra in Marathi, that affidavit of evidence he drafts at the time of a plaint and he locks it and keep it. So he knows what his evidence is going to be at the time of drafting of a plaint. And the client knows that, look, this is what I have said on oath before my lawyer and I have to stand by it. And this is the burden of proof that I need to meet. So it was a practice that he was following. I personally followed that practice in three of my matters and the results were wonderful. Because you have that safety, you know, you have that safety that you know at somewhere that, no, I know my evidence. I know how it looks like, how it's going to look like. So that's something important. Please remember. In fact, in one of the case, I will just tell you one last example, that there was a case where certain people were coming to demolish certain structures. I had two options. I could have filed a suit for simpliciter injunction. In fact, that was filed by the lawyers there. What I'm telling you happens to be from a place called Jejuri or Pune district. And there is what is called as a Palki Margav, on which Sant Jnaneshwar's Palki, you know, the palanquin, they proceed every year. So they wanted to widen that road and they given certain notices to the adjoining bungalow or adjoining structure holders that please remove your construction, we need to widen the road. They immediately filed the suit for injunction. To their horror, they realized that the civil court's jurisdiction is barred under the Highways Act. The civil court doesn't have a jurisdiction. Rightly, civil court refused to exercise it. In fact, they didn't even give a date to them. The registrar said, we can't register this. Somehow I entered the picture, and then I in some other matter knew that there is section 23 and 24 of the Highways Act which say that if you file a simple appeal to the collector against that demolition, that's enough. So client told me, sir, I don't have any documents now. These are all old structures. We don't have even a title document. We don't know what is it. We have been given just 48-hour notice. Fortunately, this provision came to my rescue. This provision said, the moment you approach the collector, there will be automatic stay to the demolition proceedings or further proceedings, you know. So frankly speaking, whether I have a good documentation as required in the civil court, whether do I have enough proof, whether can I discharge the burden, all these questions became immediately irrelevant, because that very golden moment, that was a golden moment for them, because if you don't stop them from demolishing, then nothing remains in the matter. It becomes a paper decree. The restitution and all is good in paper, but it doesn't really happen that way. So in that golden hour and golden moment, we could immediately go to collector, and collector, the moment we got the inward number with the collector, we told the authorities that, look, we have filed an appeal and there is an automatic stay. You can't proceed till my appeal is decided. We all know how much time it takes with the collectors and these revenue authorities for a matter to be decided. Still, they chose to take, they came, we approached the High Court, and High Court said, you can't do that. There is an automatic stay. So it did not happen. Nothing happened really in that matter. The structures were not demolished till date. So the point I am telling you is that please do thorough research with the facts and the law before you undertake your journey and the voyage. Similar, like if you see at Order 7, if you plead fraud and coercion, we are going to deal with that. You need to specifically aver and prove, you know, that there is a fraud, there is a coercion. The moment you use these words, the burden that falling on your shoulders is tremendous. If you look at section 101, 103, 103 for that matter, if the parties want the court to believe in existence of certain facts, then the burden lies on that party to prove those facts. So if you want the court to believe that there was a fraud, there was a coercion, there was undue influence, all those factors in the Contract Act, then the burden is heavy on your shoulders to prove that. So be mindful of the words that you use in a plaint. That's most important. Adverse possession for that matter. I have seen so many enthusiastic lawyer taking the plea of adverse possession where the burden is phenomenally high. It's phenomenal. You can't have that burden of proof if you don't have the documents to support your claim. Can you show it's an hostile possession? Can you show it to be an open one? Can you show it to be peaceful one? Can you show it to be public in nature, visible? And all those ingredients, when it started, from when are you computing the period of adverse possession? How it become adverse? What is the nature of proof that you have? Was it permissive in any way? Were you tenant there? You know, all that, please think over it before you take up that plea. Never ever say ki sahib, you know, in Marathi we say, apni tito khub varsha rahto, aata amis malak zalo, you know, that we are staying for so long now, we have become owner. That's not the adverse possession looks like. That's not how it looks like. So please make sure that you have a theory before you proceed, and that theory is well supported. Now let's begin with the plaint structure. In all these matters, the structure of the plaint, because as I told you that at least for 10 to 15 minutes more, I'll be talking in general of declaration, recovery, and all this. Before I begin on that, I would need really a response from the all the participants that do you want me to tell you about this pleading part in general, or do you want me to begin specifically with the declaration and all that little dry part immediately? I please want the answers from the participants. I don't want to unnecessarily embark on a journey that the participants do not want me to start, because this is I need to hear from you. So please unmute and let me know if it's fine. Hello. Am I audible? Can any one of you please?
They are writing in the chat box. Start with the specific suits, they are saying.
Okay, sure. So should I directly start with the specific performance? Because I'll be very frank. I will be, of course, dealing with those specific suits. But for the first almost 15 minutes more, I was planning to take it the way to deal with those suits. But as if the participants really want me to start with it, then I'll immediately start. Is it the consensus that should I just skip that?
They're saying just an overview and then please start.
I'll start specifically with that. Only 5 minutes more on the general part because I'm shortening it now. Yes, I have the replies with me. Friends, just four stages before you start any of these suits. The first stage, what I call, is the madman stage. Now, what is madman stage? Let me tell you. Madman stage is, now this is what I follow in any suit. The mad stage is that you try to gather as much as information that you can, where you don't just think about structure, you don't think about the form, you don't think about anything else, but you just gather the information. That's what I called a madman. Then there is a stage that I personally call a stage of an architect, where you try to putting the things together and you try to formulate a structure. That's what I called an architect stage. Third stage, and I'll be basically dealing with that when I also come to the specific suits. The stage that I call is the carpenter stage, where you actually put the paragraphs and then you start to make it look like a plant when the journey really begins. And the final stage will be the stage of a judge, when you critically analyze your draft and critically analyze your plant. So these are the four stages from which every plant that we draft passes through. And I think it's important that we really have it in this format. Now let's begin with a specific suits. See, frankly speaking, there are innumerable litigations that we come across: specific performance, recovery of money, cancellation, and all that. In any of these suits, the first portion and the first part must address these things, and these are called five important questions that you need to ask. First is who, what, when, where, why, and how. Suppose it's a specific performance suit. The question they need to ask is who are going to be the parties to this litigation. The moment I get the answer to this question, I get the proper parties and necessary parties. Unless I ask myself this question as to who are going to be the parties, I can't start with a suit. So the first question is who, where you get the answers which are really falling under order one, the parties to the litigation. In any specific performance suit, the essential parties are, of course, the parties to the deed and the document. The subject matter deed, in fact. Now, specific performance can be also of the oral agreements. And of course, the burden of proof, I told you initially, is exponentially high in case of the oral agreements. There, it is important to see really who are the parties, who are going to be the parties to the litigation. In certain cases, where there is already a third party interest created in the property before you really started with the suits, then you need to also make these third parties a party to the suit, because they, though they are not proper parties, they become the necessary parties. So the reason I told you that this who question is very important. Next question that you really ask is about what. Now, what is the question which really pertains to description of a property? In any specific performance suit, the most crucial part, and let me also mention the partition suit, or for that matter, any suit with respect to immovable property, the most important portion is the description of the property. My advice will always be that please do not borrow the description of the property from any notice that you pick up. Please borrow it from the latest property card extract that you will get if you inquire with your client. Only after you get it, then please paste that paragraph or paste that description to your plaint, please do not borrow it from any other correspondence. Because misdescription of a property in a suit for a specific performance is, in fact, there was a talk by some Calcutta High Court judge who said that in 30% of the matters of the specific performance, the amendment applications that are filed were pertaining to the misdescription of the suit property. So this what question assumes a great importance when the suit is about the immovable property. Most importantly, this what question, sorry, who question, as we asked in the first, will also give you the encumbrance holder's name. If you look at the property extracts, like in Maharashtra, we have the itar hakka. You know, itar hakka means the rights of other holders. So you would also know the names of the people who are holding encumbrance over the property. That encumbrance holders, you must know the nature of the encumbrance that they have over the suit property. That will help you greatly to decide who are going to be the parties and what's going to be the suit property's description. What are essential averments in suits? If you look at certain provisions, you will find that, of course, there is Order 6, Rule 3, that there are forms of pleadings in Appendix A. If you all have the CPC Bare Act with you, please visit Appendix A, where there are certain forms which are given of the suits for different kinds. There are defenses given in a suit for recovery of money, in redemption suits. For example, if you look at, let's visit first pleadings part, Appendix A, you would find there is a format given for each kind of suit. This is rarely seen by the lawyers, but I find this always helps you to really give you the basic essentials of any suit. Of course, you can have your facts added to this, but this gives you really the basics of it. For example, if you look at form number 3, it's a suit for recovery of money. Then if you look at form number 13, it's for breach of an agreement to purchase the land. I do not wish to take you through all these forms. You can visit these forms, but these forms do give you certain essentials that you must include in your plaint, because these are the basic essentials that every judge will look for in your plaint. For example, there was this readiness and willingness part now that has been omitted by the recent amendment of 2018 of the Specific Relief Act. But that was considered to be an essential pleading in any specific performance suit. But unfortunately, I don't know the reason, the CPC has not been amended. So I think, subject to correction, the still has those wording of readiness and willingness in CPC. But as there is a judgment of the Bombay High Court, I will share the citations, of course, later, which says that these forms are mandatory. Mandatory in the sense not that if you miss them, then the suit will be vitiated, but in the sense that you must try to abide by structure as much as possible. So this is something that you must always remember, to have a look at the form before you really start drafting your plaint. Most important portion comes about, there are certain mandatory averments in certain kinds of suits. See, the suits that we are talking about are not only pertaining to specific relief or specific performance. There are suits even in family courts. Maybe the legislatures are different, but there are also applications for probate, letters of administration, and there are so many kinds of litigations. In these litigations, there are certain mandatory statements that you need to make. For example, in family matters, you need to say that the suit is not a collusive suit. You know, in probate and letters of administration matters, you need to aver that this deceased was last residing at so and so. So always remember that whenever you start drafting a litigation or a plaint, please make sure that what are the essential averments that the law requires me to put into this draft. Please do not miss out on those essential averments. For example, if you go to Order 37 summary suit, friends, let me just tell you the reason I'm discussing all of them together. This is how I'm going to deal with it, because it doesn't make a sense to first tell you about the format, and then again tell you same thing about the recovery of money, and again tell you the same thing for summary suit. This is the by and large going to be the structure, and I'm going to tell you essential lookouts. Summary suit, for example, if you take order 37, essentially it is required to be titled as a summary suit. There are judgments which say that if this is not done, then that the suit has to be dismissed or has to be returned because it's going to fail because of a formal defect. Order 7 rule 10, a return of a plaint. Of course, you can't invoke order 7 rule 11 rejection of a plaint because this lapse is not of that gravity, but the courts have invoked order 7 rule 10 for this defect of not writing a title in the summary suit. So please remember that whenever you are drafting a plaint of any nature whatsoever, there are certain essential averments that you need to make. Please make sure that you make those averments. Then the question comes as to the third question. The first, of course, who, what, and then where. Where I take it that it's about the territorial jurisdiction. In a specific performance suit or in a partition suit or any suit pertaining to the immovable property, if you look at from the sections beginning onwards from 15, 16 to 20 of the CPC, you would find these jurisdictional clauses that these suits are filed in the courts where the immovable property or part of it is situated. So this where question takes us to the part of the jurisdiction. Why question takes us to the cause of action? Because cause of action is something that's most crucial part of any plaint, which is haphazardly done several times. But suppose if it's a suit for a specific performance, you need to specifically aver as to what was the date agreed for performance of a contract. Because it is after that date, you have to really count the period of 3 years. And we will be looking at the articles which give us these 3 years for filing of a suit. If it's a recovery of money suit, you need to say that the when amount fell due. From that date, we have to count the period of 3 years. It's similarly, it's a suit for a declaration under Section 31 of the Specific Relief Act. Again, you need to say that when the right to sue first accrued to me, from that date, you need to count these 3 years. So this cause of action, when and why, is most crucial part of any litigation. If you come to a specific performance suit, it's 3 years, Article 54. From the date when the performance was supposed to be done. And if there is no date fixed, then it is to be counted from the date when the plaintiff has a notice of refusal to perform the contract. If you come to the suit for a declaration, since we are on the topic of a limitation, it's 3 years from the date when the right to sue first accrues. That's Article 58. And for the possession, Article 65, which is 12 years from the date when the possession of the defendant becomes adverse. There are three important exemptions from the limitations in these kind of suits. The first exemption is under Section 14 of the Limitation Act, what we call as the proceedings in the court of incompetent jurisdiction. If your suit is beyond limitation, you need to take these exemptions and you need to make specific pleadings about these exemptions. For example, suppose there was a suit that you had filed in the court which did not have the jurisdiction and you prosecuted that suit in good faith and with due diligence. This is what Section 14 language talks about. Then end of the day, you realize that, sorry, this court doesn't have a jurisdiction. That's what the court tells you. You withdraw the suit, you go to another court of a competent jurisdiction. There you take this defense of Section 14 and say, look, I was prosecuting my suit in good faith in some court which did not have the jurisdiction. So please give me the exemption of the time from the filing of that suit till disposal of that suit. And you get that period omitted and then you come to this court. That's Section 14, what we call the exemption. Important exemption is again Section 18. 18 is an acknowledgement of a liability, particularly in monetary suits. You will find that if the defendant has admitted his liability, then the period of limitation begins to run afresh. Okay, so let's say that the amount fell due in 2011. The defendant admits his debt in the year 2013. That admission has to be in writing, it has to be signed. There are these elements of Section 18. We will not read out the sections. I'm just trying to cover up the important portions of the limitation and the exemptions. Then you have to specifically plead that, look, he admitted his liability in the year 2013. So my clock of limitation is reset and it starts to run afresh from 2013 and it goes till 2016, 3 years from 2013. Most important portion that you must remember is that this period or this acknowledgement has to be within the prescribed period of limitation. What I mean thereby is this, that if the amount fell due in the year 2011, the admission of liability must be before 3 years. If he admits his debt in the year 2015, that's of no use to you because that's an admission beyond the period of 3 years. That admission of liability must be before the expiry of 3 years period and the clock begins to run again. This is what section 18 looks like. So basically, these are the limitations for different suits, which you will find in the article section of the Limitation Act. Now let's go to the recovery suit, and now let's start to cover separately essentials of every suit. If you come to recovery suits, money recovery suits, you have a limitation of 3 years again to recover your money. The options that you have is order 37, a summary suit. Summary suits are the suits where the long procedure of any ordinary litigation is cut short tremendously, and you directly become entitled to a decree in the event defendant does not show up, or defendant does show up but does not give adequate answer or defense to your claim. The procedure goes like this, that you draft the summary suit. Most essential, as I told you, in a summary suit is the title, that this is being filed under order 37. This is a summary suit. This is the admitted liability. This suit is based on this check, promissory note or hundi. Now, I'm not going to discuss the very basic stuff as to what these really mean and what do we mean by these terms. Basically, it means that admitted liability on an instrument. And this is the amount that is due. In most important portion in any recovery of money suit is the particulars of claim. These particulars of claim can be a part of the plaint itself, or I follow the practice, I put it as a schedule to the plaint, because schedule gives you little liberty and little clarity. You can put it in a schedule. You have to very categorically identify the amount, principal amount due. Then you have to calculate the interest. Now, for claiming the interest, you must look at the contractual document. Are you entitled to claim a specific rate of interest, or are you going by the bank interest? Now, this is the interest that you claim till you file the suit. Okay. After you have filed the suit, again, from that date till the date of decree, you get an interest. Okay. What we call an interest pendentilite, the interest during the pendency of a litigation. And the interest that we just spoke about was the interest pre-litigation. So basically, you have to calculate these claims and bifurcate them in your schedule of in schedule A, what you call, in your particulars of claim. So recovery suits, most important portion comes about the particulars of claim and the title that you give. Of course, if you choose to go for a summary suit, just to tell you in short, the summary suit procedure is kind of an easy procedure, that where you file a suit, you serve the summons to the defendant. Defendant has to appear within 10 days after service of summons to him. If he puts his wakalatnama, he puts his appearance, the plaintiff has to serve him what we call as a summons for judgment. The summons for judgment is nothing but a document wherein he is asked as to why the plaintiff should not be directly given a judgment of the amount that he claims to be due. The defendant has to come out with what's called as a leave to defend within 10 days. A leave to defend is nothing but again a permission that the defendant asks to the court that, look, these are my defenses, please allow me to defend his claim. The court will then take a call as to whether is it looks to be it's a moonshine defense. That's a term coined by several judges, whether it's just a sham, just it's a lame defense. If it looks to be a lame defense, the court will ask him to first deposit certain amount and then will grant him the leave to defend, which is what we call a conditional leave to defend, which can be again challenged, of course. Or if the court feels that no, this seems to be a good defense, the court can give him unconditional leave to defend. If that leave to defend is given, it becomes an ordinary suit, what we call as a regular suit. It ceases to be the summary suit, and then the suit proceeds like an ordinary suit. The reason I must tell you that I'm also talking about recovery suit is that because there are n number of recovery suits filed in the court, and if you look at the topic that we are discussing today, the topic is really various suits, including the suits for, of course, specific performance. So we need to really cover up as much as suits as we can, including the suits that have been specifically given in the syllabus today. So we are done with the summary suit. As I told you, the most important portion is the top portion, and there are certain other requisites as admitted liability and particulars of claim. Now, coming to the recovery of possession suit, and we are now beginning with the specific relief act. There are two sections that you find. Is first is section 5 and second is section 6 in specific relief act. Section 5 gives you a right to file a suit based on your title. You can file a suit for a possession based on your title, or you can file a suit for possession, what we call as a prescription title, the possession by prescription. It means title by prescription. It means that you are in long-standing possession of certain property, and therefore you become entitled to that property. This is what we call as a prescriptive title. Section 5 deals with recovery on the basis of the title deed. In such kind of section 5 suits, of course, the limitation is 12 years. Again, if you look at Article 64 and 65 of the Limitation Act, the possession suits are given the limitation of 12 years. This 12 years is little longer than other limitations that you find in the Limitation Act, because possession has been considered to be the most essential right of a person. To dispossess someone is like taking away his valuable right. So possession has been given a little longer breathing time, and you find it 12 years. Section 5 suits, as I told you, at the beginning, the reason I told you that the structure remains the same, because most important is the description of the immovable property. Okay, if you look at again order 6 and order 7, description of the immovable property, most crucial. Then as to when the cause of action arose in your case, as to count the limitation period, as to when the possession of the defendant turned adverse to you, that starting point of limitation to define that is the most crucial aspect. So in section 5, generally the suits proceed like the normal suits for recovery. What is crucial is section 6 suits. Section 6 suits is a very interesting category, where even a trespasser can maintain a suit. Of course, he can't maintain it against the true owner. That's what the judgment says. But a trespasser can maintain a suit under section 6. So under section 6, you need not ever and plead about the documents of title that you have, because you don't have any. So you have to be very cautious while filing a section 6 suit, because there the burden of proof is absolutely different. It has got a completely different color. This litigation has got something, a very different complexion. You just tell the court that, look, I was in peaceful possession of this property for so long. I was dispossessed by the defendant without following the due procedure of law, and I have come to the court within 6 months from the date I am dispossessed. So if you comply with these three essential ingredients, then your suit for section 6 does lie in the court of law. Interestingly enough, there is no appeal against the order that is passed in section 6 suit. We go in civil revision application, CRA. Because the appeal has been prohibited, and if I'm not wrong, also the review is prohibited under section 6 of the specific relief act. So these are the suits where you just go on the basis of your possession and tell the court that, look, I am in possession. So there you don't really annex the title documents. What you annex to the suit are the documents that show your possession. Okay, vis-a-vis the suits under section 5, where the important annexure to your plaint is going to be the document of a title. So this is basically the two different sections that really talk about the possession. Coming to the now specific performance, specific relief, rescission of contract, cancellation, damages, compensation, and this class of the suits. Friends, as we all know, these are the reliefs in equity. They are, you need to have some basic idea before we really know the plaints as to why they are called reliefs on equity, because that has got a major bearing on how you draft the plaint. There is something called as a common law, we all are aware of. After Norman conquest of UK, of England, you had the common law. In common law, you go by the precedent or the earlier judgment, what we call a stare decisis doctrine. And there you have, they used to have the set formats in England, whereby you had to only draft and plead in that particular format. If you do not have the format, then sorry, your suit is not maintainable. That's what was the at the time of Henry II. We won't go too much into that, but that's what the plight of common law jurisdiction was like. That if your suit does not fall within any of those precedents, the likelihood of you getting justice was minimal. And therefore, people used to petition to the judge, to the chancellor, or to the king, in fact, that time, that please look into this. The common law jurisdiction is not able to give me any relief. So we have come to you, please give us the relief. And he used to delegate that work to his chancellor, what we today know as prime minister. And chancellor used to distribute the justice. He used to deliver the justice, looking at the equity. He did not go by the form. He did not go by the law. He did not go by the statutes. He did not go by the judgments. He just went by his sense of equity. Now, being the court of equity, these were called the chancery courts because they were looked after by the chancellor. They were done from the Westminster Hall, as is today famous, in the House of Lords building. Being the equity courts, they were not bound by the set rules of procedure. Now, this is very important factor when you really talk of equity jurisdictions, because you need to make sure in your plaint, when you are filing a suit for a specific performance or contract, or maybe other suits like injunction, that you plead this equity portion very elaborately. And here you get the essential ingredients of the suits for injunction, where you need to show balance of convenience, where you need to show prima facie case, you need to show irreparable loss. All these ingredients flow from this equity jurisdiction, which you need to really elaborate in your plaint. So coming to the first category of suits of the specific performance of a contract, section 9 to 25. I'll just tell you one important judgment before we really start with those discussions, which specifically tell you what are the remedies that you have. Yes. Okay. See, in a specific performance of a contract, it's not necessary that you ask for any other relief. But in certain cases, you need to ask for a relief, which is called as a relief of a declaration. What do I mean by that? Suppose if you file a suit for a specific performance of an agreement to sell that you have with the defendant, which is left unexecuted. Fine, you can file that suit. But suppose that in the meantime, that very defendant has mischievously executed another agreement to sell with some third party, then you don't need to just stop, or you can't just stop at seeking specific performance of your agreement. What you need to also seek is the declaration that particular instrument is not binding on you. Now look at the situation that you are claiming really two different and distinct reliefs, but they're arising not from...
Hello, Yuvraj, can I disturb you, intervene a bit?
Please.
There's a question there. Do you want to take questions now or later?
The way you want it. I really have no problem.
What is convenient for you? Because
I don't mind taking it now. If it's really relevant.
Do you want me to read it?
No, ma'am. I'll read it myself. I'll just
give
it a second. Is it proper to claim negative declaration? That's asking. Okay. There is a question that can we ask for a negative declaration? See, negative declaration is something that's not recognized and you really can't ask for it. Negative injunctions, of course, can be asked, which of course you are aware of, that to stop someone from doing something, and that's statutorily recognized, the negative injunctions that we will be dealing in some time. Well, the Supreme Court has time and again said that negative injunctions are enforceable. Negative declaration is, there are again two kinds of things. Negative declaration, suppose, let's say that I want to file a suit in a court of law saying that B is not my wife. Okay, now please correct me, Mr. Patil, that if I am taking this example, if it sounds wrong to you, but as I understand your question, I want to file a suit in a court of law saying that B is not my wife because I want to claim a negative declaration because this lady is on her spree of claiming herself to be my wife and I need to get that declaration. It is unlikely or it is impossible for a law to give such a negative declaration because declaration, implicit in declaration, is the concept of a positive declaration. That if someone is denying something to you, if you look at section 31, please we'll visit section 31. If there is a cloud on your legal character, if there is an interference and disturbance in your legal character, then you file a suit for a declaration. That's what section 31 tells me. And section 31 is something that I have to look at if I want to go for a declaration. I don't think there is any other section that I can. I'm really sorry. I have been saying section 31. I meant section 34. I'm extremely sorry for that mistake. 31 is cancellation. 34 is about a declaration. So section 34 tells me that only if there is a cloud over my legal character, I can go to the court of law. Now, be calling herself to be my wife is not cloud on my title or is not cloud on my legal character. On the contrary, if I need to seek a positive declaration, I can, yes, certainly go to the court of law for a positive declaration because any contrary claim to my legal right would qualify to be a cloud under section 34. Because if you allow these negative declarations to happen in the court of law, there will be a floodgate of litigation. Everyone would want to come to the court and say, look, I'm not entitled for this. He is not entitled for that. They should not do that. That's something the declaration really doesn't work like that. I think that solves your query, or is there something more that I need to address? Mr. Patil, can I just continue with the talk? Okay, thanks. And just let me also tell you that if you feel that, look, that person is causing me a real nuisance, if that lady is executing certain documents, projecting herself to be my wife, then certainly I can go for a probatory injunction. But just for the sake of a paper decree, I can't get a declaration because that's just wasting the time of the court because that declaration does not suffice, does not serve any purpose. If you go for, you can certainly go for a probatory injunction. Okay, so we were at specific performance. Okay, just give me some time to get back to where we were. Okay. Section 10, we were, I think, at the specific performance in respect of a contract. Specific performance suits, when you are drafting the plaint, you please be aware of three important sections in any specific performance suit. That's first is section 11, second is section 14, and third one is section 16. Because these are the sections which really decide your entitlement to the specific performance. Okay. And the judgment that I was telling you about, that's judgment of Rakesh Malhotra versus Kamaljit Singh Sandhu. That's 2019-13 SCC 342. Now, I will be only giving you some very important citations that I really feel are important in terms of pleading. There what happened was this, that A entered into an agreement with B and B executed the deed of the same property with C. So A filed a suit seeking declaration that, look, whatever B has done with C is not binding on me. Okay, this is what he filed a suit for. The Supreme Court rejected the suit, saying that, look, it's fine that whatever B did with C is wrong because that's a subsequent transaction. Your title must prevail. But at the same time, you ought to have sought a specific performance of your own agreement that you had executed with B. And you having not done that, your suit is maintainable. And we will come to that when we go to section 34. Why was it not maintainable? So please remember that the first basic that I told you, that you must list out the reliefs that you can get from the court of law. If you omit any of them without the leave of the court, then you can't sue for that relief subsequently because of order 2 rule 2 bar. Now, that if you can just visit order 2 rule 2 of CPC, you would understand what I'm telling you about, that you can't relinquish any of your claim without the permission of the court, more so in case of a declaration. Why, we will just see in a minute. Section 14, as I told you, you must be conscious of, because section 14 tells me the contract which cannot be specifically enforced. So if your contract falls in any of them, of course, we are not entitled to seek any specific performance of the contract. There is an interesting case if you wish to just have a look at. It was a very interestingly drafted plaint wherein the person asked for continuance of an employment with a particular company, saying that, look, your dismissal is wrongful. I deserve to be occupying that post. So I'm seeking specific performance of our contract of service. That's the judgment. If you can just take the citation, is 2004, 3 SCC 172. That's the case of Pure Line Liners versus Manorama Sarsi. Court said that this is the contract which is in the nature of personal qualification of the parties and in its nature determinable. So we can't really force the employer to have you as his employee, because it depends so much on his personal volition and his personal desire. So these kind of contracts, and if you look at that judgment, there are certain averments in the plaint that are interesting to read, and the judgments talk about it. So these kind of contracts are not really enforceable. Another section that we must be conscious of while drafting these suits is section 16, where there are personal bars to reliefs. That there are certain personal bars that the law has cited that you can't really seek performance of, like you can't seek. You just, if you wish to read that section, we can read that here. 16, 15 talks of who may obtain specific performance. 16 talks of there are personal bars to relieve, and this was that section where which mandated use of word readiness and willingness. Now that pleading requirement is gone, you don't need to plead that, but you need to prove readiness and willingness. Okay. Earlier there was a requirement of pleading readiness and willingness, but just on the lighter vein, please remember that you need to plead in order to prove. So technically, if the law still mandates proving of readiness and willingness, you need to anyways plead readiness and willingness. So though it has gone from a statute book, I don't think it will really disappear from the plaints that we are going to see. Okay, so having done that, there is another important section, and that's section 21 that I wish to talk about a little bit. Ma'am, what's the time that I need to stop at? Would you just tell me? I shouldn't really exceed the timeline.
It's up to 7.
Okay. So we are well within time. Thanks.
Yeah.
Section 21, friends, talks about power to award compensation in certain cases. Please remember, in a suit for a specific performance, you can always, of course, get the specific performance of a contract. No difficulty on that. But suppose that if A has agreed to sell a land to you and he does not sell it, okay? After 3 years down the line, you realize that he doesn't want to just sell it. He was just bluffing, and he has no intention to sell it. You go for a suit for a specific performance. In this suit, invariably you will find that the parties or the lawyers ask for a specific performance of the contract. They ask in the alternate for refund of the earnest amount that you have paid to A. But rarely they ask for the compensation for the loss that they have suffered. What do I mean by loss? I'll tell you. See, if I have entered into an agreement with A to purchase a particular piece of land, and because A was going to sell it to me, I gave up so many good opportunities that came my way. I said, no, sorry, I have already entered into an agreement. I don't want to go for this purchase, though it is quite cheaper than the market rate. I gave up those opportunities. Now, in fact, this is just the case of I suffering the damages. I suffering so much because of his non-performance. And this is where the law of equity comes to my help. I'll tell you how. See, under the common law earlier, if suppose B refuses to perform certain agreement, let's take the same case. A refuses to perform certain agreement. The common law used to give me the remedy of damages, saying, okay, you have suffered your damages, please refund the earnest amount. That was the remedy in the common law. If you look at the old British judgments, the breach of contract was inevitably followed by grant of damages. The question then arose was as to what happens to my valuable right of a specific performance, why that man should be allowing to take benefit of his own wrong. After 3 years down the line, my earnest amount has become peanuts. He is just getting away with paying me my 5,000 back. So the court devised this specific relief and specific performance, and that's why it is called the course of equity. In the same vein, you have section 21 where you can ask for compensation for the loss that you have suffered. But please mind that in such cases, there are judgments of the Bombay High Court that you must in detail give the summary and particulars of the damages that you have suffered, what we call as the heads of compensation. For example, in the example that I give you, if because of loss of opportunity, I have suffered so much, you must list it. It may be a notional, but you must list it in your particulars. It can't be just because I claim it. So you have to give those particulars, because if you look at section 21, it is governed by section 73 of the Indian Contract Act. If you have the Bayer Act, please look at section 21. It specifically says that the grant of compensation under this section will be governed by section 73. Now, if you look at section 73, it talks of damages caused by breach of contract. So these damages must be in the natural course of the usual course of thing. This is what the section uses the word. The damages must have arisen naturally in the course of things. You all know the case of Hadley versus Baxendale, the remote damages, the damages which were not anticipated by the parties. So if they are remote damages, you need to specifically plead in your suit that, look, at the time of execution of this agreement, I had specifically given an intimation to the defendant that if you fail to perform this contract, I will be losing these opportunities. In effect, in one of my arbitration, this was argued that my client failed to deliver the project in a timely manner. He wanted to construct a plant and he had to deliver it. The claimant in that case specifically said that, look, we had specifically told your client that if you don't give it to us, we need to run our operations from our rented premises, and the rent is becoming huge day by day. They have the escalation clause, and they proved that. They averred that and they proved it. There was no written document, but there were witnesses to that minute, the meeting. So basically, they got remote damages, what we really call. If you need to know more about it, you can just, I think most of you know it, Hadley versus Baxendale rule, what we call. So if it's a remote damages in your plaint, you need to show, aver and plead that you had intimated in clear terms that in the event you do not perform this agreement, you are going to suffer these damages. Then only in that eventuality, you are able to recover the remote damages. Now, as I told you at the beginning, friends, these are all the things that you can't take a call about when you are in the middle of the litigation. Okay, this is something that you must do at the outset. And that's the reason I highlighted so much on the stage of what I call a madman stage. Now, madman stage, I would not go back to that. But please, again, I'm tempted to say you that 60% of the time that I spend on a brief is on this stage of a madman. Madman means the man who knows no limits. He thinks of everything. He thinks so wildly. He thinks without any limits. So you need to really think about section 73 at the time of compensation claim. You need to think of this section 21. You need to think about the judgments that have been pronounced on this section. Let me just digress for a minute and let me tell you what I'm talking about. Suppose if I get a section 21 or let's say specific performance suit, the first thing that I should be doing, of course, to gather the facts, put them in a chronology, that nothing can substitute the good chronology and all that. But before I finalize my plaint, I need to study at least 15 judgments. I'm telling you this trick that I follow myself. If you study 15 judgments on that issue, really you get a good hold of that subject, in a sense that you start realizing as to what matters in the court of law. Which are the issues that the courts really look into? Which are the pitfalls that the plaintiffs generally face in these kind of litigations? With only 15 judgments, and I'm quite aware of the resources that we have at our disposal compared to our older generation lawyers. Even if we Google something, we get not 15, but 1500 judgments on any topic that we wish to search. So please take good 15 relevant judgments and study them. That will solve most of your queries. That will show you the risk aspects involved. That will show you the pitfalls that generally the lawyers fall prey to. So in these kind of litigations, always remember to have handy at least 15 judgments. There are certain lawyers who also wave their facts around the case law. just to tell you what it means, before they go for a plaint, they take some case law and make your case look similar to that case law. Okay. Now that's something I don't really approve of, because as we all know, the case laws come and go, as we have all seen with now Section 6 and all those the judgments of the Honorable Supreme Court in the recent judgments about the woman co-partners. The judgments come and go, so it's little riskier proposition to unnecessarily wave the facts around the case law. But the via media that I have found for myself is to study good 15 judgments and then try to take a call about what averments to include and what not. Then coming back to next provision, rectification of instrument. Just by the way, before parting with Section 21, you can also seek refund of Section 21. We deal with Section 22. You can seek possession, you can seek partition, you can seek refund of earnest money in addition to the relief of specific performance. That's Section 22. I'm sorry.
Okay.
So please remember, Section 22 is very interestingly couched section. It says that refund of earnest money is a relief independent from the relief of compensation, what we just studied under Section 21. So Section 22 reliefs you will inevitably see being claimed by the lawyers in specific performance suit, that please, if you are not giving me the specific performance, refund me my money. That's fine. That's Section 22 relief. But what we essentially lose sight of is that I always would request you to use wisely, because that's something your client is always entitled for. By the way, if you don't make these averments initially, if you don't ask for these reliefs initially, Section 22 gives you a right to ask for these reliefs even at subsequent stages by way of amendments. But as they used to say in the Bombay Bar, that the number of amendments are in inverse proportion to the wiseness of the lawyer. So basically, we can't really go for too many amendments. It's better to keep the amendments minimal and do them only when it's necessary. And as I told you, if you do the exercises that I told you at the beginning, the passing through say different stages, then there is hardly need of any amendment. Rectification of instruments is something, again, important section. That's Section 26. Whenever a document is executed by fraud or a mistake, and it does not express the real expression of the parties or expression of a real the intention of the parties, you can go for rectification of the instrument. I'll give you an example. Suppose if A files a suit for a specific performance of an agreement which gives him a right to purchase 3,000 square feet of a land. B, when is served with the summons of the suit, realizes to his horror, oh, I could not have promised him 3,000. All I have is 2,500, because rest 500 I have already agreed to sell it to some other person. So this is an overlapping portion. Okay, this 500 square feet is something that I shouldn't have agreed to sell to A. In that suit, defendant can file a counterclaim, and we all know, I would not trouble you with order 8, the counterclaim is at par with the plaint. It's as good as a different suit, susceptible to different value, separate valuation and all, limitation same. So he can, in the same suit, file a counterclaim seeking rectification of that instrument, saying that, look, this 500 is excess, please make it 2,500. It is by mutual mistake that this mistake has taken place, and then you have to give a very high standard of proof to show that it's a mutual mistake. Okay, or it's by fraud that A has got me executed, A has made me execute this document wherein I agreed to sell him 3,000 square feet. All I have is 2,500 left with me. So rectification comes to your rescue in these kind of suits where really there has crept in some error because of the mistake of the parties. Most interestingly, a plaintiff can also seek rectification and then specific performance. What I mean, I'll tell you. Suppose if A knows, as a matter of fact, that B did not have 3,000 square feet with him to sell it to me, all he has is 2,500. In that case, A can first claim relief A that please rectify the instrument to make it 2,500 and then specifically perform that instrument. So these kind of prayers are perfectly maintainable, and in fact, this is what is the intention of Section 26. Okay, so there are judgments which allow these kind of exercise. Coming to next section of rescission of contracts, which is again a very important section, that's Section 27. Any party interested in the contract may sue for getting it rescinded, provided the contract has to be void or voidable. Now, what are the void contracts? Which are the voidable? The fraud, coercion, and all that. You are all aware of the Indian Contract Act. So if your contract is void or if it's voidable, you can always go to the court for rescinding the contract. So always remember, whenever you are confronted with a contract, you have three options. You can go for a specific performance of that contract, you can go for a rectification of that contract, or you can go for rescission of that contract. In addition to these principal three remedies, you of course have the remedies that section 21 and 22 gives you. Refund of earnest money, partition, possession, compensation, damages. These are all consequential reliefs that you can always get, and of course injunction. That's again a consequential relief that we are going to deal with in a short while. Rescission of contract is again, you need to, as I told you, the format remains the same. Plead the contract, plead the facts, the open with the introduction, who are the parties, what happened, what was the body of the, what was the body of the agreement, what were the terms that were agreed upon. And then coming back to the end portion, you have the valuation, jurisdiction, cause of action, and the prayers. So this is what the rescission looks like. Coming back to the next portion, which is really important, is chapter 6 declaratory decrees that we were talking about for so long. That is section 34. One of our friends asked a query as to can we seek a negative declaration. Friends, as we can see from this section, the declarations can be sought if there is any legal character or any right to the property. If you have these two essential ingredients, then you can certainly go for a suit for a declaration. But always remember, the declaratory suits, the judgment is always in personam. It's never in rem. The judgment is binding only on the party to the litigation. That's what section 35 tells us about. So even if you get a declaration, suppose if I get a declaration, I file a suit against B, and I get a declaration that Taj Mahal belongs to me. Now this declaration is something that's virtually useless in before against any person, but only is binding against B, for a very simple reason that anyone can tomorrow bring a collusive suit and get any declaration that they get that they want. So basically the section 35 limits the operation of these decrees to inter personam and not in rem. Most crucial aspect of section 34 that you must remember is that whenever, and this is very important in terms of the plaint, that whenever you are seeking a declaration, please make sure that there is no other relief that you can ask for. If you are entitled to even single relief over and above declaration, then you have to ask for it. Otherwise, the suit gets dismissed because of Section 34. Section 34 says that if the party is in a position to ask for more than something more than declaration, and if the party doesn't do that, then the suit has to be dismissed. This is what section 34 tells us. So as I told you, the initial stage again assumes the importance of knowing what reliefs our client wishes to get, and instead of only seeking the relief, suppose now it's a very interesting example of what Mr. Patil gave, the example that I gave in response to his question, that B claims to be my wife and is going registering certain documents. If I seek a negative declaration that B is not my wife, let's assume that it's maintainable for a minute. I need to also seek an injunction against her, restraining her from executing any such documents. If I don't do that, in fact, that's what the principal relief should be instead of a declaration. If I get that, sorry, if I don't ask for that, then my suit is liable to be dismissed under section 34, because this is what section 34 tells me, that your suit is liable to be dismissed if you fail to ask for any relief over and above declaration. The logic is very simple. Declaration is considered to be only a paper decree. The declaratory suits, the declaratory decrees cannot be put in execution under order 21. The like you put in execution the specific performance, you put in execution the recovery of money, you can't put in execution declaratory suits. Declaratory suits are self-serving. All you have is the piece of a paper. Okay, so the court says don't waste the time of the court. If you can ask for something more, please ask for it now. If you don't, we are going to dismiss your suit. Now there is another very important judgment that you please take note of. That's Anathula Sudhakar versus Bucci Reddy, P. Bucci Reddy. That's 2008-4 SCC 594. There, the courts have held that if you are seeking recovery of a specific immovable property, then you can just ask for recovery of possession. That's it. You don't need to ask for a declaration that the property belongs to me. Okay. Now, this is really the interpreting of few sections, and allow me to do that. Otherwise, we won't be able to do study the case laws. We are discussing now section 5-6. Along with recovery of possession, the recovery of possession sections, along with section 34. There the court said that if you are really seeking recovery of a specific immovable property, what generally people are tempted to do is that they seek the recovery of possession, they also seek declaration of their title. The Supreme Court had said that, look, you don't need to seek a declaration of a title in a suit for recovery of possession. You need to seek the declaration only if there is a clog on your title, if there is a cloud over your legal right. If I know as a matter of fact that no, there is no cloud at all in over my title, there I just need to have an injunction for that matter, I need to have recovery of my possession, then you can simpliciter go for recovery of possession. And this is what the Supreme Courts have said in the case of Anathula Sudhakar. The Supreme Court in the same breath has also said that suits for prohibitory injunction, simpliciter, are also maintainable. You don't need to really ask for declaration in all these cases. Reasons are not difficult to find. Burden of proof. If I'm seeking a declaration, I need to show the title. If I need to show the title, I need to have the document. If I have to have the document, I need to make sure whether it falls under section 61 to 65, primary evidence, secondary evidence. Do I have the enough proof to prove it? All that I need to make sure before I go for a suit. If don't, simpliciter ask for recovery of possession. That's as simple as that. Sounds simple, but when it comes to actually drafting of the plaint, these questions are really major questions that you need to address. Then now we will little rush through rest of the because we need to really cover, because the topic is so wide. Another judgment, if you wish to just take a note, state of Uttarakhand versus Mandir Shri Lakshman Siddha Maharaj, it's 2017 ninth volume, 2017 9th volume, SCC 579. This is an important judgment for plaints. The courts have given the important material averments that you must make in a suit for a declaration. That what are the essential averments that a plaint must contain? And the courts have given a very beautiful elaborate description of the averments, saying as why it is necessary. It just doesn't say that it is necessary. It also tells you why it is necessary. It says you must give the origin of your title. You must give the ancestry, from where did you derive the title. You must tell as to what's the problem with your title right now, why you need to seek the declaration. And there are almost 14 to 17 heads that the courts have elaborated that the plaint must contain. Another judgment, so we'll just take note of few and then we'll move on. Union of India versus Vasavi Cooperative Housing Society. That's 2014, second volume, SCC 269. There the courts have said that in a suit for declaration of a title, the burden of proof is on the plaintiff and it needs to be discharged by him in his plaint itself. Even if in these kind of suits, written statement contains something absurd, still the suit cannot be decreed if the plaint itself is defective. And then what the plaint should contain is, of course, discussed in detail. The section 34 principle that we spoke about, just one judgment of Venkat Raja versus Vidyane, is 2014, 14th volume, SCC 502. The courts have said the same thing, declaratory suits without any other consequential relief. Courts have said, sorry, the suits are not maintainable. One judgment of the example that I gave you, a person filed for declaration of his marital status. That judgment you can just take. It's a reported recent judgment of 2017 of Justice Nariman. 2017, 9th volume, SCC 591, where the parties filed a suit about the legal declaration, the declaration of their legal character as a husband and wife. And the there was a very important observation made by the court. The other side took an objection that how a suit is maintainable in the civil court. because this must go to the family court since it pertains to the legal character of the husband and wife. Because tomorrow anyone will file a suit saying that please declare that my marriage with Y is dissolved, he can file a civil suit. So the respondent therein said that, sorry, how this suit is maintainable? It must go to the family court. The Supreme Court there said no. If you look at section 9 of the CPC, it is couched in the widest term possible that civil court has the jurisdiction to try all kinds of suits. So unless the applicant is relating his cause of action to section 13 of Hindu Marriage Act or any other sections for nullity, for divorce, you can't force him to go to family court. He can maintain his suit in the civil court, and that's what the judgment is about. Please read it. It's a very interesting reading. Coming back to the kind of a last portion of our talk today, it's chapter 8 of the perpetual injunctions. As we all know, the perpetual injunctions can be granted. I wouldn't take you to the text of the sections. Injunction is to stop someone from doing something detrimental to your property or your enjoyment of your right. You can go for a perpetual injunction, provided you need to show that the compensation in money is not adequate relief, multiplicity proceedings need to be avoided, and there is no standard for ascertaining actual damage. And of course, that all these ingredients you will find in section 38, that right to enjoyment is threatened. In addition to that, what you need to really plead in your suit, in these kind of suits, is order 39 ingredients. Because if you look at it, section 38 onwards, which deal with the injunctions, substantive provisions. The procedural provisions you will find in order 39, order 38, 39, of course 39 onwards. You will find order 39 containing the procedure to enforce the rights that the section 38 gives you. So basically, you need to incorporate all those ingredients in your plan for injunction. Most crucial portion is as to explaining your right over the property, one. And secondly, when there was a threat to dispossess or when there was a threat to the enjoyment of your property. What generally happens is this, that in the gist for a shorter plaint, of course, there is an old school of thought, and which is the right school of thought, that the plaint has to be the short one and it has to be precise one. But generally in this gist, we should not lose sight of the fact that we need to elaborately discuss in these kind of suits your right over the property and why are you seeking an injunction. And you need to really fulfill these elements in your pleadings. Please don't only say that this cannot be compensated in terms of money. I have a prima facie case, balance of conveniences. These averments would not suffice. My advice and what I do personally is that I make sure that the paragraphs that I'm putting in my plaint bear out these elements. Okay. And let the paragraphs end with these averments, that from the aforesaid, it can be seen that the prima facie case is in the favor of the plaintiff. From the aforesaid, it can be seen that the balance of convenience is in the favor of the plaintiff. If my sugar cane is cut, if they come, I will be starved, and this is what it is. So please make sure that your averments spell out the ingredients. When I'm talking of the ingredients, please don't mistaken me for bare ingredients. That's not the way to draft. Your plaint should make out the ingredients. Certain injunctions that you might be aware of, but just on the end note, and then to open it for question and answer, I'll mention the quia tamet injunctions. There is a new breed of injunctions that has come in, particularly in the IP sector. Quia tamet injunctions mean that injunctions where the threat has not yet happened, but it's imminent. You're anticipating that this will happen. Okay. Generally, in an injunction suit, you must show that, look, there is a disturbance, there is a threat, there is a present threat. But in the quia tamet injunctions, you can show that there is an imminent threat. And then there are judgments of Novartis. There are Delhi High Court is quite a leading high court for giving this. And Bombay High Court is, for that matter, quite leading in giving these injunctions. Where the Novartis has obtained certain injunction against Ranbaxy from manufacturing a drug. The drug had not yet come into the market, but the court gave an injunction saying that Ranbaxy has gone to the patent officer for revoking of a patent of Novartis. This itself shows that Ranbaxy has every intention to launch the product, so we are giving the injunction. So this was a quia tamet injunction, the injunction in anticipation. If you wish to read the articles, Shamnath Bashir, if you all know the IP expert and the man who is no more with us, excellent articles he has written on quia tamet injunction. The most essential ingredient of a plaint is the imminent threat. forget everything. The imminency or the anticipation is something which is most crucial. Then John Doe injunctions, I think most of you might have heard of it, it's now routinely granted. It's basically against the person who is anonymous. You don't know the respondents, you don't know the defendants. For example, if you make a movie, that movie you find on torrent or you find on some web portal, you don't know who are the pirates who have done it, who have copied it. You go to the court against the anonymous defendants. John Doe is basically a term they use for XYZ. Okay, someone anonymous. And then you get an injunction against undefined persons. And then you go to Google or torrent and then ask them to get it down because the court has given an injunction. So there is another very important and interesting breed of injunctions that has not yet reached India, but you should all know it for the sake of records. Super injunctions. Super injunction is something the Britain courts are now granting day in, day out. It means that suppose if in a recent, let's take a recent example, just academically, that a celebrity goes to the court and says that, look, there is a media trial going on. Please restrain the media from reporting anything about my case. It's an injunction they ask against a specific news channel. The court gives that injunction. Now that news channel does what? They put it a headline that the court has injuncted us from showing the case of this actress. Now, because the people are now more curious, it's like a forbidden fruit. The people become more curious as to know as to what's happening in her case. So they will go to the court and they will take out the documents. So in that case, celebrities sometimes want the reporters not to even report the injunction news. So the injunction is a black injunction. It's invisible injunction. The reporters can't even report the injunction. Forget about reporting the affair. They can't even report the injunction. That's called the super injunction, which has now been granted routinely by the UK courts. And I don't think there is any difficulty in granting it here as well. Then there are Antenpillar orders, which is not really an injunction, but Antenpillar orders are really the orders you ask the court commissioner to go and search the premises of some person. What you need to aver is that there is an imminent threat of destruction of the subject matter. If you don't immediately rush, then there is going to be the destruction of the subject matter. Then you get the Antenpillar orders. What you need to really show is that there is a strong prima facie case. One, the respondent or the defendant is in possession of the subject matter goods that of which I want the inspection. And thirdly, that it would do no harm to the defendant if you give that order. So I think if you comply with these, that then these kind of injunctions are Antenpillar are quite routinely given. The judgment, if you wish to take the leading judgment on this, is the Antenpillar versus manufacturing process. It's a Lord Denning's judgment. From this party comes the term Antenpillar. Okay, you can just Google it, you will find the text of the judgment where Lord Denning has enumerated the aspects that need to take care in Antenpillar cases. Section 39, now coming to section 39, mandatory injunctions. Sometimes you don't need to just have the prohibitory injunctions. We need to have the mandatory injunctions, that is to perform the positive duty or to compel someone to do something. Again, the same factors, the prima facie case, irreparable loss, balance of convenience, existence of a positive obligation that he must do it. You can go for a mandatory injunction. And section 40, if you look at, you can ask for damages in lieu of or in addition to injunction, as we saw, probably little analogous to section 21. So you can ask for damages in lieu of injunction. Only thing is that if you look at section 42, it says that no relief of damages can be granted and you specifically pray for it in the plaint. But if you look at all these reliefs, equitable reliefs that we really spoke about today, you will find all these averments are necessary. The prayers are necessary. For damages, you need to make a separate prayer. For partition, you need to make a separate prayer. For possession, you need to make it. But if you don't make it, specific relief act particularly grants you the liberty of moving the amendment even subsequently. If you go at order 6 rule 17, you know there are certain riders which have been put in place. Now the courts do not go by the rigors of that order and that rule. The courts go by the specific relief act because again it's an equity jurisdiction. Party should not suffer because of some technical lapse on his part in the plaint. Court allows you to amend it when you move it. Of course, it has to be diligent one. 41 is again, injunctions can be refused in certain circumstances, and those injunctions, the circumstances have been listed. We must make sure that our case doesn't fall in that. And last, little related to the questions that again asked by our learned friend, injunctions to perform negative agreement. There are certain terms of the contract which survive lapse of a contract, or which survive end of a contract. For example, I enter into agreement of a partnership with you, and we both agree at the time of a dissolution of a partnership that we will not enter into this business for next 5 years. The dissolution deed has been signed, fine. But if someone attempts to enter into that business, then of course you get this what is called as a negative injunction. Or like the recent, I think the case of Reliance and Biyani, the Big Bazaar, there is a covenant of not entering into it for 15 years. Again, you have to see whether it's a reasonable one, because it's an agreement in restraint of a trade. But reasonable or restraints have been held to be valid, unreasonable are not. But that's a different case. Negative covenants can certainly be enforced. You can have the judgment, a good judgment on this, which gives a bird's eye view as to what should be the essential requirements of a plaintiff in such kind of suits. Hardesh Ors versus Head, 2007, 5th volume, SCC 614. The court says that negative agreements can be, of course, enforced, and the general outlook on the negative injunctions. Last, partition suits. Friends, in the partition suits, I must tell you, what's most crucial is the questions that we asked ourselves, the who, what, and where. You have to always begin in a partition suit that this is what we are. These are the plaintiffs. You must look at who are all the family members, and they all have to be joined in it as a defendants. Otherwise, the partition suits are the worst hit suits with the plea of misjoinder and non-joinder. So in the partition suit, you must make sure that all the family members are taken care of. In the first paragraph, I always prefer myself, not first or second, first few paragraphs, to write a family tree. And just below that, write for clarity that he is the defendant number 1, 2, 3, 4 and all that. Not only put the family tree, also put the description of the parties, that he is my so-and-so, he is my so-and-so. So in that, it's very important. How you have, how the property or how that nucleus has been acquired. Very important averment in a partition suit, that it is acquired from the joint family property. If it is acquired, self-acquired, then how it is merged, you know, doctrine of merger, how it is merged into common hodgepodge. So please be aware that on a parting note, I will tell you that anticipation is most crucial part in any pleading or in a plaint. You must anticipate what the written statement is going to be like. If you do that, suppose if you know that this property, this defendant is not going to let go. He is going to have it. He is going to call it as a self-acquired property, and he has got the documents to show it. In that event, you can play safe. You can say that this was apparently acquired in his name, but that was merged in the common affairs of the joint family, in the joint family business. On the contrary, if you falsely claim that this is a joint family property, then when the WS come, then you start running for an amendment, you start for running for additional pleadings and all that. But if you can anticipate that, then I think you can really take care of all these possible defenses. So these are the essential ingredients of a partner, the partition suit. You have to list the co-partner, you have to list it's a self-acquired or what, you have to say that there does not exist whatever any family arrangement prior. If there exists a previous partition deed, you have to seek a declaration that it is not bind because of these factors. If there is a partition deed which you feel is not worth of seeking declaration, it has to be ignored. You can just say that in a plain that there was an understanding, but that was never worked upon, and that was left in halfway. If you don't do that, then the defendant will come with a plea that there is a case of a previous partition. You can't repartition a property. So the anticipation is the most essential ingredient in these kind of suits, because the previous partition deed is a big threat to the success of your suit. Then how do you propose to do the partition? What is the share that each party will get? You have to carve out the shares, and you must then finally include all the properties in a separate schedule to be on safer side. Movable ka, there will be one schedule, immovable ka one schedule, and then the other properties if you wish to mention. So these are the essential formats of the property. Last issue we will discuss is whether the partition, in the suit for a partition, can you really ask for an injunction? Because you will find that the judgments have been that a co-sharer or the co-owner can't ask for an injunction against other co-owner because they are all tenants in common. But there are certain judgments where the courts have held that yes, an injunction relief is also maintainable if you show that the act of the defendant is such a in such a nature that it will affect not only my enjoyment, it will diminish the value of the property. So please hold your hands till the partition suit is decided. The courts can give that relief. You need to have the judgment. It's the old judgment of Chedi Lal versus Chote Lal. It's AIR 1951, Allahabad 199. So, and there is one more of Bhartu versus Ram Swarup. You, the citation of which you will find in this very same judgment. So with this, I would like to end just with the final parting remark that a plaint is an exercise that's most essential in any litigation. And as I told you, that please only have a regard to if the court has a jurisdiction, if there are any bars to the jurisdiction. For example, if you go to MRTP, there is a specifically civil court jurisdiction is barred. I came across a case from Ichalkaranji where, if you know, there is a lapsing of a reservation after 10 years. Okay, if the government doesn't acquire a property after 10 years, the reservation lapses and you can get the property de-reserved. The property again belongs to you. Rather, you can use the property, it of course belongs to you. In that case, the party had filed a suit for a declaration that please declare the property has been released from the clutches of MRTP Act because 10 years have gone by. You haven't acquired it in spite of my notice under section 127 of MRTP. You won't believe there is a bar to this jurisdiction under 149, if I'm not wrong, of MRTP. Still, the court decreed the suit. The municipal corporation people started the acquisition proceedings. When our client went there with the decree, they said, this is a paper decree, it's a nullity. We are not going to act on that. He filed a suit, he filed an appeal. Of course, he was not an aggrieved party. He could not have filed an appeal. He still filed an appeal. Appeal was not registered. We went to High Court. And then there was a judgment of Justice Morey, which says that, fine, of course, there was a bar of jurisdiction. But considering the plight of this plaintiff, that he having fought this litigation for 10 years and municipal council having contested it on merits for 10 years, not on the ground of lack of jurisdiction, but on merits, we think this is a fit case for release of the land. But that was an exceptional case. So please remember that. Please look at if there is a bar to the suit or there is a need for any previous notice. Okay, like you have the notice to be given to the government under CPC, you have a notice to be given to a society. Like if you go to a charity commissioner, then they need to take permission of a charity commissioner before filing a suit against a trust. So these are the essential ingredients that you please take care of. And I would advise you all that I have done for myself, please prepare a format that this is what I am going to look at. This is the introduction, these are the body, these are the conclusive paragraph. Whenever a case come to me, I'll try to fit this into these paragraphs. If you do that, then there is a good likelihood of you covering everything. With this, sorry, I was in the last, there was some problem with my throat because we have kind of a lost the practice of talking too much in the virtual hearing because the hearings are getting over in 2 minutes, 3 minutes, good for us. But the days have gone when we used to argue in the court on our legs and then used to talk so much. Thanks a lot again for your cooperation. I'm opening it for the question and answer if we do have a time.
Do you want me to read or you can check it on the
okay, I'll just read, ma'am. Mr. Vikas Sopti has asked, is it possible to take shelter of specific reliefs if one of the party invokes arbitration clause? See, in arbitration clause, if one of the parties invoking, then it's unlikely that you can take the specific performance because under Section 8 of the Arbitration Act, no suit is maintainable when there is an arbitration clause. But if that other party had submitted some statement on merits to your suit of a specific performance, then his right of invocation of arbitration under Section 8 is forfeited. Then you can very well bring him in the civil court. But if there is an arbitration clause, out goes the court, out goes the civil law system. What remains is the arbitration. So I think that answers your query. Mr. Sopti again asks me, can remedies be sought as a parallel course of action? Arbitration versus no, may not be. But in these cases, let me tell you, then there are judgments of the Supreme Court in Booz Allen, if I'm not wrong, where the Supreme Court had said that the specific relief suits and the suits of these nature are enforceable even by arbitral tribunal. So these are the arbitrable disputes. So I don't think that there should be a conflict between these two remedies. Why to go on parallelly? There can't be a parallel litigation because there will be a case of a contradictory decrees between civil court and arbitration. I think arbitration will prevail end of the day. He asks me, usually parties take help of Section 9 of Arbitration Act and safeguards themselves by taking help from court. Of course, because Section 9 is an interim relief, and then that that's something that's the most important weapon in the arbitration regime, where you can protect your interests till the arbitration actually begins. Because you need to go to Section 11, get the arbitrator appointed. Generally, if you see now, the trend is this, in the High Court at least, that if you go under Section 9, the High Court says, why should I exercise and waste my time under Section 9? I'll straightway appoint the arbitrator and let this application be treated as an application under Section 17 of the Arbitration Act, where let him take a call about interim relief. Why should I interfere in the arbitral process? So yes, that's right. Section 9 has been taken care of. Is it necessary always to seek declaration first in a suit for injunction? As I told you, the judgment, and in fact, I'll be sharing the judgments with ma'am. No, at all, not at all, because as I told you, burden of proof is very heavy in these kind of suits if you seek a declaration. Because in a declaration, you have to show two things, that you are entitled for a legal character and you are entitled for a right, and there is a cloud over that right. Vis-a-vis injunction, all you need to show is that, look, I'm in a settled position. Please don't disturb my position. You might be a trespasser also, but no one can take law in his own hands under Section 6, if you see. So the burden of proof in section, the injunction is quite lower than what you have in declaration. So the Anathula Sudhakar's case tells us you don't need to ask for a declaration in these cases. Is it necessary to bring all the properties of the joint family in the suit, though there is no dispute regarding some properties? I take this question is in context of the partition suit. Is it necessary to bring all the properties of the joint family in a suit? Of course, it's not about having a dispute about the properties. It's having the properties for inspection of the court to partition them. In a partition suit, very interesting feature, if you all know, Supreme Court has said in partition suit, every party is a plaintiff and every party is a defendant. So merely because you stand in the shoes of the defendant doesn't make you a defendant. You are also plaintiff because you are also entitled to get the same share as that of a plaintiff. So merely because some property is not disputed cannot be a ground not to include that property. You must and must include all the properties available, which are joint family properties, in the suit for a partition. Under which situation a partial partition is permissible? There are judgments where this has been very beautifully discussed. If you wish, I'll share the citations, that there are certain circumstances where the partition, frankly speaking, there is this view that the partial partition is not permissible, and there are conflicting judgments. In fact, there's a judgment of the Bombay High Court in their 2017 saying this. I'll share the citation which specifically erupted the instances where the partial partition can be permitted. The majority of the judgments in the favor of the partial partition cannot be permitted. Partition has to go as a whole. The few circumstances, I'll share the judgment with the, of course, the ma'am at the end of the session. Manavi Priya, if there is an oral partition which was filed decades ago, a plain seeking partition is filed today, feigning total ignorance of it, what's the best course of action for the defendants? Now, there is an oral partition which is, there are minutes of that. The plain of partition is filed today, feigning total ignorance. So probably I take it that he is deliberately ignoring it. Then the defendant has to plead and prove that, look, there was an oral partition. One, what's in these cases more important to plead is that this partition, oral partition, was acted upon by the parties. How do you show that? You can show in Marathi what we call as a khatefod. You know, for example, in Sadbara, in 712th extract on the property document, if you can show that separate shares have been given to separate parties, they are in possession of their respective shares from that year, you know, then this is circumstantial evidence which will show that there was an oral partition. In addition to, of course, the witnesses that you might have for that oral partition, you can, of course, put that all in the WS. What's the period of limitation? Oh, sorry, I missed one. Manavi Priya, if there is an oral, okay, thank you. What is the period of limitation for a suit for possession on the basis of a title? It would be Article 65, period of 12 years would be the limitation, especially in the light of defense of a limitation, since the plaint itself does not disclose the partition. Achha, it's a follow-up query, especially in the light of a defense of a limitation, No, there is a question of limitation in the partition suit. See, there can't be a question of a limitation in the partition suit. It's a continuing cause of action, technically speaking. You know, so especially in the light of defense of limitation, since the plaint itself does not disclose the partition and therefore makes it stable. No, I frankly don't get the query so well. But just to tell you that limitation doesn't really come in, you know, when we are talking of a partition, and 711 may not be really the right remedy in these kind of cases. If Ms. Priya wants to, whether declaratory suit of civil death can be filed, of course it can be filed. Why not? And there are judgments, and that's, I think, section 107 or 108 of the Evidence Act, wherein you can, if the person is not heard of for last 7 years, then the suit can be filed. Then there are 107 and 108 where the burden of proof is reversed. If he is not heard of in last 7 years, then he's presumed to be dead, and the one who has to show that he alive, the burden of proof is on him. And the situation changes in other section, that if he has been heard of in last few years, then he is presumed to be living person, and the burden to prove that he is dead shifts on the person who says it. Sometimes, since the question has been asked by Gaurav, I'll also tell you, in such cases, generally the person asks that who's to make a defendant in this kind of suit. Because if I want to get a declaration that a person is dead, then there is a judgment of the Bombay High Court which says that the collector should be made a party defendant in these kind of suits. Now, I don't know what interest the collector would have to deny this fact, except that he has to prepare one, maybe a death certificate. Apart from that, documentary compliance, he has no reason to oppose it. But instead of having the suit without any defendant, I think the Bombay High Court has now said that let there be a defendant collector. And I think the collector will come and admit the claim. Okay, so with this, okay, thanks a lot for all your patient listening. I hope I did not transgress a lot, but let me tell you very frankly that the practicing lawyers have the temptation of unnecessarily sharing sometimes their experiences, which I personally feel are necessary sometimes. But it was a wonderful session. Oh, okay. There is one more.
There's one more question.
Oh, okay. Okay. But the jurisdiction changes. Now, I don't know what Gaurav really wants to say. Jurisdiction changes. Okay. Gaurav, can you please elaborate? If collector is a defendant, the jurisdiction changes. No, it doesn't change. The defendants can never change the jurisdiction. The jurisdiction is changed only by territory, the pecuniary and the subject matter. Collector, adding collector as a defendant, never changes the jurisdiction. Okay, Jibin has some query. Whether the suit for declaration can be filed for rectification of a share in a revenue record on the basis of previous oral partition. No, this is too many things combined. Declaration for a rectification of a share in revenue record on a basis of... No, see, you don't need to do that. This is quite complex litigation that you are creating. All you need to do is to seek... you need to approach the revenue authorities to say that, look, there is an oral partition. You need to apply to Talati saying that there is an oral partition. You need to bifurcate the shares on the basis of this. Please bifurcate the shares. Okay. What you really want to ask is this. First, you need to get a declaration that there is an oral partition. Okay. Get that decree to the revenue officer and then ask him to own it. You can't really club these two into one litigation. First, get a declaration of an oral partition and then get the revenue records mutated. I think that should be the answer to your query. Yeah.
Any more questions?
Yeah, I'll be sharing citations. Surely, whichever I have referred and which I wanted to, but I could not because of some paucity of time, I will certainly be sharing them.
Yuvraj, thank you so much.
Thank you
for an elaborate session, and it was really something which I enjoyed after a long time.
You being there was a big thing for us, because it's like being taught by the ma'am and then speaking in front of the ma'am.
And I want to tell you that this course was designed by Kanatkar, sir.
Oh, no, you can just see that from the structure itself. You can know that.
yeah, that's what. And we are very proud of the fact that we have such good people with us who can help the college.
Yes.
Thank you. And I hope to see you again. We are going to have a course on appeals. So I'll need your help in that.
Surely, ma'am.
appeals and revision and everything. So
okay,
I'll give you a help because you just have talked about appeals. So, and you've been practicing on the appellate side. So your inputs will be highly appreciated.
Surely, I'll be. It will be my pleasure to do that.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot, all, and all the best. Thank you.
Yeah. All the best to you.
Thank you.
ते हे काय करा बस काहीतरी सांगणार होते तेजसला पाठवलंस ना हे दीपाली दीपाली